The topic for today is Lefort fracture, and that is the Lefort 1. Now in my last video for the maxillary fractures, in the introduction of it, I have said Lefort, he was a person who tried this experiment and there was this three fracture lines which he got. That was the Lefort 1, 2 and 3. So starting off with the first Lefort 1. It is a mid-face fracture. Now what is mid-face fracture? So your face, it is divided into three parts, upper, middle and lower. So your middle face is nothing but it is from, superiorly it is from the frontozygomatic suture on the either side. So this is the line, superiorly frontozygomatic suture from here, and inferiorly it is from the occlusal plane of the maxilla. So this is nothing but the mid face, that is superiorly from the frontozygomatic suture and inferiorly it is the occlusal plane of maxilla, and this is your mid face. So starting off with the first, that is the Lefort 1. Now Lefort 1 is also known as floating maxilla, low level fracture, then horizontal or transverse fracture, Guerin's fracture, subzygomatic fracture, or it is also known as pterygomaxillary disjunction. Why Lefort 1 has so many synonyms? So rather than just mugging this name, you have to understand the concept why they have so many synonyms. So watch the video till the end to know the exact meaning why they are known so and so. Now starting off with the Lefort 1, so what is the etiology behind it? So the forces, so this type of fracture, it results from the application of horizontal forces which are just above the apices of the maxillary teeth. So in this, the force is a high velocity force which is applied in a horizontal direction, and this force is applied above the apices of your maxillary teeth. So these are your apices, so these are your roots. So the apices over here is your, so the force which is applied on it, it is above the apices of the maxillary teeth. Type of Lefort 1 fracture which is usually undiagnosed, and that is the impacted or a telescopic fracture. So this telescopic or impacted fracture, it results due to the transmission of the blow from the opposite jaw, which is often impacted. So impacted is nothing but, now in this maxilla, it is known as floating maxilla because the maxilla, it gets separated from the middle third, rest of the middle third. But now in this impacted Lefort 1 fracture, your posterior, so your maxilla, it is not disimpacted or it is not separated from the superior structures of the midface, and hence it is known as impacted or a telescopic fracture, and this is a type of a Lefort 1 fracture. Now starting off with the main topic, that is the fracture lines of your Lefort 1. Now how this fracture, it runs, your Lefort 1, it has two lines, that is the lateral and medial. So now starting off with the lateral line, so laterally the fracture line, it starts from the lateral margin of the anterior nasal aperture. Or it is also known as spiriform aperture. So it is from the lateral margin of the anterior nasal aperture or from the lateral margin of your spiriform aperture. So this is the lateral margin of your anterior nasal aperture. So the starting point for the fracture line is from this, laterally. Then it runs horizontally above the nasal floor and the canine fossa. So this is the second point of your fracture line, that is it runs, so it is starting from this point, then it runs, now this is your nasal floor, so it runs above this nasal floor and the canine fossa. Now what is canine fossa? So canine fossa is basically a depression which is present above the apices of the canine. So this is a depression which is present on the maxilla. So the line, it runs horizontally above the nasal floor and the, so this is your canine, above the canine fossa. Then it crosses the anterolateral wall of the maxillary sinus . So this is your maxillary sinus, crosses the anterolateral wall of the maxillary sinus. So this is your maxillary sinus, it crosses the anterolateral wall of it. So anterolateral wall is nothing but the wall which is facing facially. So it crosses that line and then it runs upwards and posteriorly across the posterior maxilla. So it runs across the upwards and posteriorly across the posterior maxilla. So in this, this is your posterior maxilla. So it is running across this posterior maxilla and then, and this is below the zygomatic bone. So over here, this is your zygomatic bone. So it is running posteriorly below the zygomatic bone. And then it fractures the lower one third of the pterygoid lamina and the associated palatine bone. So this is your lateral plate of the pterygoid bone. So now your pterygoid bone, it is divided into three parts. That is the lower, middle and upper. So you have to remember this. It fractures the lower one third. It fractures the lower one third. And this becomes the differentiating point between the leaflet 1, 2 and 3. Because in leaflet 2, it will not fracture from the lower, but it will fracture from the middle. So this is the differentiating point, how you can differentiate between leaflet 1, 2 and 3. So now after that, so it runs upwards and posteriorly the posterior maxilla below the zygomatic bone. And then lastly, it fractures the one third of the pterygoid laminae and the associated palatine bones. So this becomes your lateral line. So laterally, now again, it starts from the lateral margin of the anterior nasal aperture. Then it runs horizontally above the nasal floor and the canine fossa. Then it crosses anterolateral wall of your maxillary sinus. It runs upward and backwards, posteriorly the posterior maxilla below the zygomatic bone. So it is, this line is below the zygomatic bone and hence it is known as subzygomatic. Then the line, now you, the fracture line, you'll see it is a bit of horizontal in shape. So it is known as horizontal or transverse fracture and is below the zygomatic bone and hence it is subzygomatic fracture. And low level is because now your face, mid face, it is, so this fracture, leaflet 1 fracture is at the low level of your mid face. So hence it is known as low level. So low level, horizontal, transverse and subzygomatic. The reason behind this we have seen. And then it fractures the one third of the pterygoid lamina and the associated palatine bone. Now medially, the line, it crosses from the lower third of the nasal septum. So this is your nasal septum. So it crosses from the lower third of the nasal septum. Then the lateral margin of the anterior nasal aperture, that is the lateral wall of the nose. And then it proceeds posteriorly to join the lateral fracture behind the tuberosity. So this is when it becomes bilateral. So this medial line, it joins the lateral line and it becomes bilateral behind the, so it is usually behind the tuberosity, behind your maxillary tuberosity, and this becomes your medial line. Now this fracture line, it results in the disjunction, that is nothing but the separation of the maxilla from the pterygoid plate. So this is your pterygoid plate. So there is the separation of the maxilla from the pterygoid plate of the sphenoid bone and hence it is known as pterygomaxillary disjunction. Disjunction is nothing but the separation of your pterygoid bone and the maxillary bone. So it is nothing but the pterygomaxillary disjunction. Now moving on towards the clinical features of leaflet 1. So in clinical features, now you'll see there is swelling of the upper lip. Next clinical feature is the absence of the gross facial edema. Now this becomes the distinguishing point from the leaflet 2 and 3. In 2 and 3 you will see gross edema, facial edema, because there is involvement of orbit in those. But in leaflet 1 there is no involvement of the orbit and because of that there is absence of the gross facial edema. So these two are the most important points when you are writing the clinical features of the Lefort 1. The next clinical feature is nasal block. So nasal block is nothing but it is a mucosal tear in the maxillary or the ethmoidal sinus, and it induces bleeding, that is known as epistaxis. So there is epistaxis which is present. The next one is urine sign. Now what is this urine sign? Urine sign is nothing but there is ecchymosis in the palate. So this is your palate. So there is ecchymosis in the palate near the greater palatine foramen area, which is present bilaterally. So this is again a main clinical feature of Lefort 1, and hence it is known as Guerin's fracture, because you will see this Guerin sign, that is nothing but the ecchymosis at the area of greater palatine foramen, which is bilaterally, and it becomes the classical finding of Lefort 1. The next one is the elongated face, because now your maxilla, it is separated from the mid face, and because of that it appears as a elongated face. Next sign is the premature contact of the molar, which is known as molar gagging, posterior molar gagging. So this is nothing but the posterior gagging of the occlusion. It becomes a potential threat to the airway, and this is nothing but the posterior gagging, which is the premature contact of molar. Now this is because when the maxilla is separated, it moves downwards and backwards, and because of that there is premature contact of the molars, and this can lead to anterior open bite. So these are the differences that you'll see in the occlusion. So there is undisplaced incomplete Lefort 1, in that you'll see no occlusion disturbances, but when it is a complete Lefort 1, it shows anterior open bite and the premature contact of the molars. Now the next sign, it can be teeth fracture. So it can be like there is a damage to the cusp of the tip. The next sign you can see is palatal fracture. So commonly a mid palatine split is associated with Lefort 1, and it is evident as a linear mucosal tear in the mid palate. So there is this palatal fracture in the mid palatine region. Next feature you'll see is a crack pot sound. So when you're percussing the maxillary teeth, it is similar to the sound of a cracked china pot that is tapped with a spoon. So when you are tapping a china pot with the spoon, the same sound you will hear when you are percussing the maxillary teeth. Then the next is the floating maxilla. Floating maxilla is because the maxilla, it is completely separated from the middle third and it is mobile. So when you are moving this maxilla, you will see the mobility, and hence it is known as floating maxilla. Then there is mobility at the anterior nasal spine. So you'll see there is mobility in the anterior nasal spine, and this becomes a differentiating feature from Lefort 2 and 3, because in Lefort 2 you will see the mobility at the infraorbital margin, and in Lefort 3 you will see the mobility at the frontozygomatic suture. So this becomes the differentiating features of the Lefort 1, 2 and 3. And these all are the clinical features. And one more clinical feature is, there is, when you are palpating it, so it reveals tenderness and step deformity at the zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So there is step deformity at zygomaticomaxillary buttress. So these all are the clinical features of Lefort 1. Now the next part is the diagnosis. Now how are you going to diagnose this case? So it comes into clinical features, and the next is the radiographs. Now in radiograph, in clinical features, you will see all these features, and the differentiating point is the mobility at the anterior nasal spine, the Guerin sign, then there is the absence of the gross facial edema. All this sign, it will help to differentiate between Lefort 1, 2 and 3. The radiographically, you will see there is opacity of the maxillary sinus. So the maxillary sinus, it get opacified because it is filled with blood. And the most important radiograph that you take to see this Lefort 1 fracture is the Waters view. The other diagnostic feature, it can be CT scan. So CT scan, it helps, it reveals the fracture line properly. and this is all about the diagnosis, clinical feature, fracture line, etiology and the synonyms of your LeFort 1. The last part is the management of it. How are you going to manage this case now? So the general principle of the management of fracture, it is divided into three parts. So that is nothing but reduction, fixation and immobilization. So as we know, when any of the bone it gets fractured, you're immobilizing it. For example, if the hands or the legs, they are getting fractured, then you're immobilizing it with the help of a plaster so that the wound or the bone it gets healed properly, so that the fracture it gets healed properly. So that is nothing but the immobilization. For any fracture of any bone, you need to immobilize it. As we have already seen, mobility, it can delay the healing of the bone. So there is immobilization, reduction. Now in reduction, you will see there is open reduction and closed reduction. And in fixation, there are internal fixation and external fixation. Though this external fixation, they're not commonly used now. The ones which we use is the internal fixation. Now about this, like in depth about the treatment plan, what is this reduction? What are the indication of open and closed reduction? And what is this fixation and immobilization? I'm going to cover in a video for the management of your all LeFort 1, 2 and 3. So this was all about the clinical features, then the fracture line, synonyms, etiology and the diagnosis. How are you going to diagnose the LeFort 1 case? And this was all about LeFort 1. Thank you so much.